Welcome. We're glad you joined us for another service at the Potter's House Christian Fellowship Church. We pray that God will speak to you and give you hope for your life.
Amen. If you have your Bibles tonight, 1 Peter chapter 3, in God's Word, 1 Peter chapter 3. I recently read a story about a woman named Sarah. She's a registered nurse, so she's always dealing with different people, different personalities. And she found herself taking care of and caring for a patient named Alex. Alex just happened to be very openly critical about religion. And during their conversations, Alex would often express his skepticism in Christianity and religion in general. He would even make snide remarks about faith and how he disagreed with it. Now, Sarah, she was a devout Christian, and she could have easily gotten discouraged or confrontational with Alex, but she chose a different path. And the approach that she took was one where she decided, hey, I'm just going to listen patiently to this guy, and I'm going to try to, you know, bring truth to him as I'm having to work with him. You know, the nurse-patient relationship, it actually gets pretty personal, right? There's things that go on that they have to be comfortable with each other. And so here's Sarah, as she's there with Alex, he started to ask questions and voice his doubts. And instead of being sharp or cutting, Sarah just decided she was going to respond with gentleness, with respect. She spoke to Alex about her own journey with faith and how she came to know Jesus as her Savior, how he brought her peace and strength for her life, especially during challenging and difficult times in her life. Sarah never pressured Alex or tried to be overly preachy to him, but she just decided, I'm going to live an example. I'm going to live a testimony. And in, she used kindness, love, and central theme of her faith to actually make impact in her positive attitude and genuine care for Alex and his well-being. It began to chip away at his criticism, and he was in there for quite a number of days. And one of the days, as Sarah was checking in on Alex, he surprised her and he said, you know, I've never thought I'd say this, but the way you treat everyone, even me, it makes me wonder if there's something to this whole Christian faith thing. Sarah just smiled and she says, that's wonderful, Alex. It's very important that you find what gives true meaning to life and what gives purpose to life, and I hope that you come to Jesus. Now, Alex didn't get converted while he was in the hospital. He never gave his life to Jesus while he was there. But what ended up happening through Sarah's gentle and respectful approach is that a seed was planted. And Alex would later follow up, and she sowed Christ's love through her actions, through being ready to give an answer about her faith with gentleness and respect. And the result wasn't an immediate conversion, but there was a softening to Alex's heart, an openness to God's word, an openness to Jesus Christ and his forgiveness, which eventually led to Alex later on giving his life to Christ. It took some time, but it ended up working out. And you know, I want to preach tonight about bringing hope to the hopeless, because we're going to be surrounded by people in our life that are in difficult situations, but we have the hope that people need, amen? When we have Jesus, we have the hope in a hopeless and broken world. If you're there, let's read this, 1 Peter chapter 3, we're going to begin reading in verse 13. The Word of God says this, and who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of their threats or be troubled, But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and with fear, having a good conscience, that when you when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. For it is better, if it is the will of God, to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. Amen. I want you to think with me, first of all, tonight about the Christ-centered dedication. You know, our walk with God needs to be centered on Jesus Christ. Our relationship needs to be built on the rock, the chief cornerstone, who is Jesus Christ. And we are living in a world that's constantly changing, right? Rapidly changing. Last night, my wife and I were talking, and she said, she was telling me about how her boss was showing her a new Google AI platform where you can go and you can look up. You know, AI is kind of taking over. It's not no longer chat GPT. There's all types of different AI platforms. And what that really is telling us is that we're living in a rapidly changing, a rapidly evolving world. And we can also look at things that are taking place, right? Constantly we're seeing reports about terrorism attacks, like even in places where you wouldn't imagine, you know, Russia experiencing terrorist attacks. And now, you know, there was a headline in the news that the president of Poland is telling everybody over there in those nations around him, prepare for Russia to attack. So we're living in a world that's kind of on edge, right? There's a lot of things that are going on. There's a population explosion. There's scientific breakthroughs. There's social transformations where we're being told that we need to accept right and call things that are truth and right wrong. Right? We live in a world that's kind of in a flux right now, a crazy time. But praise God that no matter what's changing around us in the world, no matter what's taking place politically, no matter what's going on in our lifetime, God's message is still the same. The Word of God has not changed. The Word of God, it stands truth as truth. And as Christians, our mission hasn't changed either. As Christians, no matter what the world is doing and no matter what's happening, God still wants us to bring hope to the hopeless. God still wants us to speak truth in a world of lies and craziness. God still wants us to walk in an arena of victory. You know, when Peter wrote our text, he was addressing believers who were also living in a rapidly changing world. They were seeing things that they hadn't experienced before. And as it is, we understand that Peter is encouraging believers to have a Christian answer ready to people who need an explanation. You know, there's going to be, with people that are hopeless and broken, there's going to be times where they're able to look at your life and see, man, there's something different about you. What makes you so different? How is it that you're having the same problems that I'm having, but you're handling them differently than I am? What is that difference? And what Peter's saying is, in those circumstances, during those times, be ready to point people to Jesus. Be ready and be confident and be bold in your relationship with God, to the point where when people are in that state of confusion, you're able to say, I'm able to get through this. I'm able to handle this because I'm saved. I'm bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm a new creation in God. In verse 15 of our text, it says, to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you. So what that is telling us, and I want you to specifically focus on that, because in those few words, we gain the understanding that there is a noticeable difference between believers and unbelievers. People will see, what is it that is different about your life? And distinctly, the difference that Peter wants us to emphasize is that we have hope. When other people don't have hope, Christians, we have hope in Jesus Christ. When everybody else is hopeless, Christians still have the hope of Jesus Christ. When everybody else has given up, the believer is saying, let's try again. When everybody else is filled with fear and despair, the Christian is focused and confident, not because we're special, not because we have some superpower, but we do have a supernatural power that's functioning in our lives. We don't have this power in and of ourselves, but we have the power of the living God working through us, and we have hope because of that. We believe in the one true deliverer and savior, Jesus Christ. Matthew 10, verse 28, do not fear those who can kill the body but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body. He's bringing some perspective here, and he's saying, listen, when you have a godly hope, it doesn't matter what anybody says or does to you. You have a heavenly hope that will bring you to another level of living. And when we are living in the will of God, all of hell can come against us. Like David said in Psalms 56, 11, in God I have put my trust. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? When we have that relationship with God, we can literally stand in the middle of the hurricane Ian's of life and say, I'm not going to be afraid because God is with me. I'm not going to be afraid because God is overshadowing me. Friend, that kind of faith, that kind of hope, it only comes from being connected to Jesus Christ. We read in Colossians chapter 1, verses 22 and 23, that Christ wants us to present you holy and blameless and above reproach in God's sight. He goes on in verse 23, he says, if indeed you continue in the faith, grounded and steadfast, and are not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you heard. So what he's saying there is that there's going to be times where we can be moved away from the faith. There's going to be difficulties. There's going to be struggles that we're going to encounter in life that do have the potential of moving us, of rocking us. But he's saying when our hope is in Jesus Christ, we can stay steadfast. We can stay grounded. We can stay solid in Jesus Christ. But our faith has and our trust has to be in him. This brings us, secondly, to a Christ-centered instruction. Again, our text, it says, but be sanctified in the Lord God in your hearts and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you. So he's literally giving us instruction there. Be sanctified in the Lord God in your heart. He's saying, allow your heart to be surrendered and sold out to Jesus Christ. So please catch what he's trying to stir us and challenge us as believers as we read this. This is talking about more than academic training. Anybody can go to school and learn about theology and systematic sermon writing, right? You can go online and you can get your online preacher certificate. Anybody can do that nowadays, right? That's why you have so many crazy people that says, oh, I'm an ordained minister. It's like, wow, okay. Good for you. Where'd you get that? Oh, I just went online. I paid $300 and they sent me a certificate in the mail. It's like, oh, that's cool. I think, maybe. I don't know. That's kind of scary. But that's what people do nowadays. And anybody can do that. But that doesn't mean that you're really truly connected to God. It doesn't mean that you have an understanding and a relationship with God that brings forth this kind of strength and this kind of power. What Peter is saying here, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. That word sanctify means to make pure or to make holy. And you know, to purify something, you have to remove the other parts that are bringing the quality down. You don't purify something by adding, you actually purify by removing. You remove the imperfections, you remove the things that don't belong there. And there are going to be times where God, he puts us in the melting pot to take things out of our life. Because there are things in every one of us that are not good for us. There are attitudes, there are mindsets, there are things that are there that have been placed in our hearts through life's experiences, through personal decisions, by opening doors to sin, by just living in a fallen world, right? By being a sinner at its fundamental. But there are things that need to be moved out of our lives so that Jesus Christ remains. But to do that, there's a process. In Acts chapter 18, verses 24 through 26, now a certain Jew named Apollos, born in Alexandria, in an eloquent man, mighty in the scriptures, came to Ephesus. This man had been instructed in the way of the Lord and been fervent in spirit. He spoke and taught accurately the things of the Lord, though he knew only of the baptism of John. So he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. When Aquila and Priscilla heard him, they took him aside and explained to him the way of God more accurately. So here's this man, Apollos. He had some Bible training. He had a fervent spirit. He had this boldness for God, and he's there speaking. But what he's preaching about is the baptism of John the Baptist. So he knew a partial revelation, but he hadn't gone to that next step of Jesus as Savior. He was still preaching the baptism of John. And so here's Aquila and Priscilla. They're saved. They're bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. They're filled with the Holy Spirit. They hear this guy preaching. They see that he's got some revelation and some understanding. They see he's got the fervent Spirit of God working in his life. He's excited. He's passionate. But what he's saying is only a partial revelation. And so they come and they say, hey, you know what? There's more to this, right? Let's add to this. And you know the great thing about Apollos is that he had a heart filled with passion and fire for God, but he was still teachable. He was still able to have Aquila and Priscilla pull him aside and give him another arena of wisdom and teaching into his life. And you know what that tells us, friend? No matter where we're at in our Christian walk, we need to stay teachable. We need to stay in the place where when God brings people into our lives, they can make spiritual deposits into us to help us and guide us and direct us and keep us on course. Peter, he was a man that wrote our text. He knew something about this. You know, Peter had his ups and downs. Peter was a very emotionally driven man. He was the guy in the Garden of Gethsemane that pulled the sword off out of the sheath and cut off one of the ears of the guards that came to arrest Jesus. He was a very passionate but a very emotional man. And so Peter understood that if there was things that were going on in our lives, we needed to be grounded in Jesus, though. And we find Peter and John, they're confronting the religious leaders of their day. They had just seen a powerful miracle. We looked at this, Acts chapter 4. We looked at this a few weeks ago. But when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, they perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men. They marveled and they realized that they had been with Jesus. I want you to understand tonight, how do we clean and purify our hearts? How do we prepare to give people the answer of our faith and the hope that they need? How do we get and keep that hope and that faith alive in our own hearts? The key is staying with Jesus. The key is staying close to Jesus, making sure that we are consistent in the fundamentals of serving God. In Psalms 27, verse 8, it says, when you seek my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, I will seek. So here's the psalmist. And he's saying, God, I want to seek your face. I want to encourage you tonight. Every one of us goes through seasons of struggle, dry times, right? We go through seasons where we don't feel like reading our Bibles. We don't feel like praying. We don't feel like going through all of the motions. I want to encourage you, though, that you would begin to pray and ask God, God, give me a hunger for your word. God, give me a hunger for your presence. God, give me a longing and a desire to speak with you and to hear you speak back to me. Because I want to encourage you, if you start to ask God to help you and to give you that hunger, he will. He wants you to seek him. He wants you to thirst for him like you're in a dry and weary land. He wants you to come to him so that you can receive from him, because he has good things for your life. Romans 5 verses 1 and 2, it says, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. This evening, you might be going through some turmoil. I want to encourage you, through Jesus, you're going to find peace. Get back to where you're allowing God to access. It says, through whom we also have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. So he's saying here, the way that we sustain, the way that we stand. There was a man that got saved in our church up in Auburn, Washington, and he would tell stories when he would, at times where he would battle and struggle with things, and he would get through it, and he would always come to me and say, Pastor, I had a hard week. I was tempted by this and by this, but I stood. I was like, oh, that's great, man, you stood. And it was just, you know, he was a Hispanic guy. He was in the gangs. Like, that was kind of slang. But what he was saying was, I got through it and I'm still standing. I made it. Yes, it was a struggle. Yes, it was hard. But I stood through it. And I withstood it. And you know what? That's what we read again and again in the Bible. Is when we stay close to God, we'll be able to stand through the trials of life. We'll be able to get through them with victory. This brings us thirdly to a Christ-centered foundation. You know, if you will love God and if you will seek Christ, your life will begin to preach sermons that are more powerful than 10,000 sermons that would ever come across the pulpit. Because when people see the sermon that your life preaches, it really makes an impact into them. You know, a lot of times people, they come to church, and Randy and I were talking about this morning. He was witnessing to a coworker, and she asked him about church, and she said, Randy, do they talk to you? And he said, yeah, they talk to me. She goes, well, I won't go to church, because she didn't want someone to talk to her. You know what that means? Is she doesn't want to be confronted. She doesn't want to have to deal with who she is. And you know, a lot of times that's how people think about church, and they just think, it's always going to be about me, and they're going to tell me how wrong I am or how bad I am. And people are afraid. They're scared quite often to come to church because they don't want to feel like they're a bad person, and they don't want to deal with shame and guilt. Like, when you don't ever hear, look at your face in the mirror, you never see how dirty it is, right? It's a lot easier not to know your hair's a mess than it is that, oh, I better deal with that. So if I just don't want to deal with it, I'm just not going to look in the mirror. You know? If you're not worried about how your breath smells, don't do that. But there are times when in life you see who you are and it's uncomfortable. But that's why we need to be living a Christian walk. Because there's going to be a million times when people don't come into church, but they see you. And your life will preach a sermon to them that is more potent, that is more anointed, that is more transformative than 10,000 sermons could ever be. Because when you live your life with meekness and fear and in a good conscience, as it says in our text, he's saying be ready in season and out of season to tell people about Jesus in meekness, which is, meekness is power under control. It's a measured strength. It's a disciplined life. And then he says in fear, which that word fear there is respect, so that you would preach, you would let your life live one of control and one of respect, having a good conscience. You know, when you're living for God, you don't have to feel bad about things. You have a clean conscience because you're just doing what God has called you to do. Matthew 5, verse 16, let your light so shine before men that they see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. So what he's telling us here is that when you're serving God, your life will just shine like a beacon, man. People will look at you and say, man, I want what you have. There's only one answer for the world that we live in, and that answer is Jesus. The only hope For people that are trapped in confusion, for people that are weighed down with temptations and frustration, that's Jesus Christ. Him risen from the grave, Him alive and ready to help and to transform. You know, this evening, I want to encourage you to dedicate yourself to Christ completely, where you just say, God, I want you to preach through me. I want people to look at my life and see you. I want people to see grace and mercy and forgiveness and kindness and love and compassion. When they see me, I want them to know that there's hope. You know, God will help us to win the lost by us serving Him, by us walking in His grace. God will use our lives to transform people. There's a coach, I close with this story. His name is Mark. He was a high school baseball coach. And he was known for his dedication to his players and his unwavering Christian faith. But one of his star players, his name's David. David is a self-proclaimed atheist. David respected his coach, but he did not respect the coach's Christian beliefs. And he never shied away from expressing his disapproval, his own opinions. He would always tell his coach, you know, I don't want to hear about that Jesus thing. Don't come talking to me. And the coach would leave his Bible on his desk, and David would make comments, why do you believe in that type of thing? And their conversation would always touch on religion, and the coach would always listen to David, but patiently. But he never compromised in his beliefs. Well, there was one game near the end of the season. It was a very crucial game, and the pressure was on everybody. David was usually one of the top hitters. Base, you know, as he goes up to the base, he was usually one of the guys that would get on base, or he would, run, get home runs, and actually be a scoring batter. But two times in that game, he struck out. And David was very frustrated with himself. He had this, when people strike out, they get this demeanor, like there's this battle going on in their head. And during one of the times where, you know, it's in between innings, the coach pulled Mark, he pulled David aside. And he just said, hey, David, how are you doing, buddy? He just kind of wanted to check in and see where his headspace was at. David mumbled, I feel like I'm letting everybody down. And he was taking those two at-bats where he struck out, he was taking it as though he was completely failing and everybody was going to be mad at him. Coach Mark, he placed his hand on David's shoulder and he says, hey, it's okay. We all have bad days. And you know, this is one thing that my faith helps me with. It helps me to stay positive in tough times. David looked down and then he blurted out, look, coach, I respect you a lot, but I don't believe in any of that stuff, so don't push it on me. He got all upset. Coach Mark just kind of gently smiled and he said, that's all right, David. Your beliefs are your beliefs. My beliefs are my beliefs. But you know that my faith, it teaches me that everyone deserves kindness and respect no matter what they believe. And so the conversation shifted back to the game. Coach Mark offered some encouragement. He gave him some pointers, all without the hint of judgment or being too harsh. But later on in the game, the bases were loaded. There was two outs, and David stepped up. It was that setup. It's a win or lose at bat, and David's the guy that has the bat. The pressure's on him. And the coach, David walked up, and he said, Coach, I've struck out twice. Can you have somebody else take this at bat? And he said, no, David, I believe in you. Go up there and I want you to do what you do. We trust you. We believe in you. And no matter what happens, it's going to be okay. David stepped to the plate. He focused and he remembered Coach Mark's words about staying positive and about having, just the confidence to do what he normally did. And then with a mighty swing, boom, he launched the game-winning home run. Grand slam, and they won the game. Everybody came running around, gave David all of his cheers. And the coach was happy. Later on, David, he came up to the coach and he said, "Coach, thanks for everything today, especially for believing in me, even when I don't believe the same things that you do." The coach said, "David, that was an amazing hit. I'm so proud of you." And he says, "There's no need to thank me, David. I was just trying to live by what I believe in. You're a phenomenal player and a good person too." And you know, the story highlights what our text is talking about. Coach Mark, he was living our text. He was ready in season and out of season. He gave a testimony of what he believed. He didn't back down. He gave an answer to David in the middle of all of his pressure there. But he didn't do that through lectures. He didn't do that through belittling, but he did it through consistent kindness. He did it through respect. And the result was David eventually came to Christ. You see, that seed of hope that was planted by Coach Mark in his heart, it grew in genuine faith. And David eventually came to the coach and said, "I want to know about your Christian faith. Can I go to church with you?" And it was there where he gave his life to Christ and his life was transformed. You know, tonight, we don't have all of the answers to everybody's little weird questions that they bring to us in life, right? You know, as people find out that you're a Christian, they're going to come to you with some crazy questions. They're going to ask you, you know, "I want you to explain to me the Nephilim." And like, it's like they're going to bring some stuff like, which came first? You know, how did Adam and Eve, like, they'll come with all kinds of weird things. You don't have to know all of those answers. But what you do have to know is that Jesus Christ is the answer for the brokenness in their heart. That Jesus Christ is the hope that they're searching for. That Jesus Christ is the one that can bring healing and deliverance in their life. You don't have to go through and figure out, like, you know, tell them how Noah built the ark. Like, you don't, like, there's questions that will come that we're like, "Oh, geez," that can cause us to be fearful of sharing our faith. But listen, don't do that. Just be ready to explain to people why you are following Jesus. And let God do all the rest of that work. Be kind, be loving, but be willing to share your faith with confidence that God will use you to make impact in the lives of others. And as you do that, you'll find, man, you're going to be surrounded by people that are following Jesus because they're following you following Jesus. And you know, we can have that kind of good testimony, that good report, as long as we stay connected and close to Jesus Christ. Let him be your foundation and see how he uses your life to make impact in the lives of others. Amen. That's all I have tonight, bringing hope to the hopeless. Let's bow our heads this evening out of respect of God and those around you.
We would like to invite you to join us in person at 18070 South Tamiami Trail, Unit 107. Our regular services are Sundays at 10:30 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. We also have midweek service at 7:30 p.m. For more information, please call 928-514-9527 or visit our website at www.pottershousefortmyers.com. We look forward to seeing you there soon.